Historical Society on BCTV is supported in part by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President Emeritus of the Historical Society of Berks County. It should be noted that this program is telecast live on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. It repeats Friday at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9. This program can also be viewed live on BCTV's website, and also you can see it on the website of the Historical Society of Berks County. You can enter our website and look for audio. It's under audio, isn't it?
Multimedia,
and you will find us there. Welcome all to the June 2011 program. Seated to my right is Kimberly Richards, Society Archivist and Director of the Henry Janssen Library.
Hi, George.
Hi, and seated to her right is Sime Bertlett, Executive Director of the Historical Society.
Evening, George.
Good evening.
I'd like to remind the audience that the Historical Society's museum, Henry Janssen Library, as well as our museum store are open Tuesday through Saturday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Also, the museum store is a great place to find new and previously owned books on Berks County history. They really are a find. Some of them are very rare, and you won't find them anyplace else. In addition, the store stocks a great number of pottery, folk art, and other items that are of local interest because they're made by Berks County craftsmen. And they provide a wonderful gift if you're having somebody from visit out of town, or if you're going to visit somebody that's out of town, why not take them a piece of Berks County's artwork that we're so noted for?
We remind viewers that for $40 a year, you could be one of us, a member of the Historical Society of Berks County. Membership in the society includes our prize-winning quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. Membership includes unlimited use of the museum and library. Incidentally, family memberships, all living in the same house, are $50 a year.
And while we're on the subject of memberships, we remind you that Berks Community Television, BCTV, is a survivor in a tough venue and a unique entity in that it's interactive. And we encourage you to call in with questions and comments at 378-0426.
Why not salute BCTV for all the great shows it provides to Reading and Berks, and send a check for $35 for a year's membership. Mail your check to BCTV, 645 Penn Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19601. Remember, time passes, but operating expenses never go away. If you haven't checked BCTV's very informative, redesigned website that features current local news, views, and articles of substance, access it at, I think we just, there it is, www.bctv.org. The website that they have has really gotten very good. I check it on a regular basis. There's a lot there that you won't find in the newspaper. It's really very good.
George, before we begin the old-time photograph features, there's some information that pertains to community interest and things like that. And the first one is, I believe, unfortunately, the death of an old friend of yours. Barry Nelson, at the age of 79, passed away on May 26th, and he was a longtime Berks County educator in the area. I wasn't fortunate enough to know the gentleman, but I understand he was a civic leader, a historian, and he wrote a number of the articles for the Historical Review of Berks County. And maybe you could, tell the audience and me a little bit about the gentleman. And
sure, Kim, what a put that on the screen. We had that one image of Barry. Can you?
It's up.
Oh, it's up. Okay.
There you go.
A little on the small side. It was an 18K image. That's Barry. Yeah, Barry Nelson lived in Shillington, and he was married to his wife, Nancy Arts Nelson, for 56 years. He was born in Adamstown and always had an interest in Adamstown. As a matter of fact, he wrote many pamphlets and booklets And among those things that he wrote were things about sports and the history of Adamstown. So he never lost his interest in Adamstown. As Cy mentioned, he was an educator, a historian. He wrote articles for any number of magazines. And he graduated in the same class as John Updike. And whenever Updike would come back, a number of his buddies from high school would get together, and Barry was always a part of that. As a matter of fact, the high school yearbook from the year that that Barry graduated is very valuable because of John Updike's picture being in there. I think he drew some cartoons and some other things that are in that high school yearbook. I've seen that go on eBay for $200.
Wow.
Yeah, because that's a very interesting thing. He taught English and history originally at Pottstown High School, and then he taught the same thing at Governor Mifflin from 59 to 64. He was assistant principal from 64 to 68, and he was principal of Governor Mifflin from 68 to 73. He helped organize the Governor Mifflin Historical Society, and he was involved with the library. And one of his lasting contributions was when Shillington had their big anniversary, he was involved with helping with the organization of that. They put a booklet out. Whenever there was a booklet or anything dealing with Shillington, he was always a part of that. Anyhow, Barry will be missed because of his writings, and he was a really, really nice fella. Again, he will be missed.
There was a home viewer, George.
Was there a home viewer?
They might have had a question on.
Okay, home viewer.
Hello.
Yes.
I've been waiting for an hour and a half, but anyway, let me ask you something. As far as the historical, I got to turn this down. Society, if you live within 4 or 6 or 8 blocks, how about those people that come in for free and take a tour? And like boost it up and say, look, this is our neighborhood, this is Reading, and the people that are further out of town, you have to charge, like all museums do. I think the neighborhood people, I live like 2 blocks away, I want to go see a fire truck, I want to walk around, and I walk from Fifth and Spring, but I have to pay. I don't feel good about that.
Well, maybe, George, should I take that one on?
Sure. For one thing, with the heat, the Historical Society is well air-conditioned. And, you know, I don't know what your bills are like, but I know what I pay for having 4 window air conditioners on full-time. There are expenses for every organization. People forget about electricity. There are a lot of lights at that Historical Society. Air conditioning is a major factor. In the wintertime, heating a building of that size, actually they heat 3 buildings, that's very considerable. And Simon, you want to take over from there?
Well, it's that, sir, and I appreciate it. Well, first of all, let me say thank you for being interested enough to say you want to come to the Historical Society.
I love this place.
Well, thank you very kindly. But George is right. There, as a 501c3, we're a nonprofit. And like I said, with
the thing is, to cut you off, the thing is, we're both from New York City, okay? And we've been here for 35 years.
Okay.
We're the original New Yorkers. You're 3 blocks away. I want to go from the basement to the first, the second floor, like the Fire Museum down at Fifth and Laurel. I'm into that. She's into that. And it's like, yeah, we'll put a donation, but don't make, like, an admission charge.
Well, I tell you what.
And not for the neighbors.
Well, we're all neighbors in Reading and Berks County.
I'll come up there and sweep for you.
We're all neighbors in Reading and Berks County, and we appreciate you wanting to come.
Shoveling the snow, you might take him up on.
Well, yeah,
especially
if it's like last year. But also, if you consider, number one, let me say this, consider joining as a member, then admission is free. But even after that, we do a number of times a year, and July will be one time. What is it, the 17th?
Yeah,
the 16th, or 17th in of July, second or third Saturday, we're having the annual HSBC block party. And admission is free from noon to 3 p.m. We also have a time during the break between Christmas and New Year's where we open the Historical Society. So, like I said, there are times during the year when we are open free of charge. Now, again, we are a 501c3. The state has cut an enormous amount of funding to organizations such as ours, the Pennsylvania Museum and Historical Commission. So
I realize that, but that's politics. But listen,
well, I understand.
I would walk up there and I would cut your grasses for like an hour or two and hedge and put things away and just show me the trucks you got and I'm happy.
Well, that's a very generous offer for you to make, sir. Like I said, I don't want to say we have our policies, but like I said, I could encourage you to join as a member and you could get in as often as you want, not to mention you'd get the historical review of Berks County. You could take advantage of the members' update.
I'm from Manhattan. Listen, I'll go up here, I'll cut the grass, and I'll trim, I'll bag everything. Let me walk around. Everybody's happy.
Well, that I understand. That's a very generous offer, but that would also put the people we employ to do that and that have been longtime employees of the Historical Society out of business. I mean, I wish I could, offer you something more.
I'm a volunteer from around the block.
Well, I tell you what. Now, that's a good you could volunteer. You could volunteer in the Henry Janssen.
I sweep streets and paint yellow lines, and I paint the fire hydrant.
Well, you could volunteer in the Henry Janssen Library. That's where we really need you. And
old Bank of Pennsylvania.
Yeah, exactly. That's M&T more recently.
There's some money in there left,
Well, why don't you give Kimberly here a call for volunteering? She needs volunteers on Friday and Saturday. Let me tell you what. You'd get admission for free, and you'd also get to work with some of the most interesting, and you'll see that later, some of the most interesting artifacts that this county or country has available.
I want to, because we're from Manhattan. I'm retired from the fire department.
Well, you'd learn a lot about the history of this county by working in the Henry Janssen Library.
Oh, I know. And this guy, Miser X, he's a nutcase. I love him.
Okay, that was a compliment, George. I promise you.
Listen, I gotta get the hell out of here.
Okay, well, thanks for stopping. And remember, call us about the block party.
Okay, let's see. Who's...
What do we got? Oh, I also need. Okay,
Kimberly.
Mr. Nelson, are you?
Yes, that's basically for Barry. Yes.
Okay, well, I do want. There are a couple other things I want to talk about. Tonight, if you all out in the audience are watching this as a live broadcast, you still have time to take advantage. This coming Friday, June 3rd, the Historical Society is having its annual 2011 Friendraiser. And like those that we've held in the past on the 175th anniversary of the Reading Railroad, John Philip Sousa, World Wars I and II on the Berks home front, this year's Friendraiser is centered around our current exhibit, Racing in Reading and Berks. And it's a very nice evening. It's an informal evening. We're having it this year at Stokesay. It'll take place between 6 p.m. and 10 p.m. It's a relaxed atmosphere. It starts with a cocktail hour, and we're going to have motorcycles and race cars on Stokesay's property for you to look at. Some of the drivers are going to be there to talk to. After the cocktail hour, we're going to have we're going to sit down for dinner, and I'll deliver a short program on the history and legacy of racing in Reading and Berks and the innovations and the first that took place here in Reading that changed the face of Reading to what we see today on the national level. So tickets for the event are $100 a person, $60 of that are tax deductible, and all the proceeds go to help fund the youth education programs of the Historical Society. So that's coming up on Friday evening, June 3rd. And then the next thing, and I'll make it real brief, that I have to talk about is the second Saturday program that's going to be taking place on Saturday, June 11th at 9:30. Refreshments start at 9:30. And we're going to have a gentleman by the name of Matt Spence who will be at the Historical Society to speak on Sam Gundy and his mentors. And Mr. Gundy was an educator and a naturalist here from Berks County, and also he was a renowned, George might be able to tell us a little bit more about Mr. Gundy, but a renowned naturalist photographer. And he had a lot of mentors here in Berks County, and he has a long legacy. Some of the mentors were Earl Poole, Levi Mengel, just to name a few. So that's going to take place on Saturday the 11th. Again, beginning at 9:30 with refreshments, and the program will start at 10. That'll go till about 10:45, question and answers afterwards, and It's going to be a great show. Admission is free to members and $5 for non-members.
So. When they're done, they can head on down to the Hendel.
And that's right. Yeah, we have Second Saturday at the Hendel and get to see what that beautiful piece of Victorian architecture is. So that's what's going on at the Historical Society. I want to introduce Kim and just, I guess, talk just briefly about... she's got some new equipment coming over to the... if you could just talk for about 2 seconds about the grant that the Wyomissing Foundation has provided for new microfilm reader scanners to update what we've had, and that's going to make a big change. Can you give just 30 seconds?
30 seconds. Next month, we will show pictures. They will be awesome. We're getting new digital microfilm readers. They're basically going to extend the life of our current microfilm. It works on a computer. It'll scan the image, and you end up kind of photoshopping it to clean it up, enlarge it, shrink it, print it, email it.
We've really had a lot of issues. The people couldn't on the microfilm
that
they
were.
They couldn't read the microfilm. They would be. And I was doing some research a couple of months ago, and it was on the director couldn't even read the. See what he was looking at. Anyway, we've been fortunate to secure a grant from the Wyomissing Foundation, the Berkshire Charitable Foundation, and the Henry Janssen Foundation to get these microfilm reader scanners. And we are, as the people that sell them, we are the first ones in the community to have these, first educational institution and even commercial institution in the county to have these microfilm reader scanners. So they are pretty special. But Kim's going to have more information on those next month.
And, pictures.
With pictures. So anyway.
Very good. The blue part, Kim. The brown part.
Right. For those of you who have been following along, the Red Eagle has carried numerous reports within the last several months concerning the moving of the Jacksonwald one-room schoolhouse. Plans were to truck it down the Boyertown Pike to the site of Exeter Township's
Owatin Elementary School.
Thank you, because there is no way I was going to remember that. After much debate and cost considerations, the decision was made to keep the 1870 structure at Jacksonwald, but to move it back a distance from its present location to a point further back on the present-day Jacksonwald Elementary School property. The move is necessitated by state plans to foreshorten the sharp turn whereupon the building now sits, to allow traffic, particularly school buses, to travel from Route 562 to the Ole Turnpike with much less of a struggle. And then we have some pictures to show you.
Yes, we do. We can have those on the screen. Mm-hmm. The pictures that you're seeing were taken, I took these yesterday. I drove by and there was a fellow digging, this is the back of the building, digging down with the idea that they're going to slide I-beams beneath and lift the thing up and move it, supposedly about 100 feet. Now the amazing part is, and I think this will, we have the next picture. This is the back of the building. You can see how they secured the corners.
Wow, with duct tape.
No, not really.
Looks like duct tape to me.
Yeah, there is a bit of duct tape there, but those corners and with the chain around the building. This is the side sort of across from the bank. Next picture, please. That's the front of the building. The front of the building faces 562. They did something somewhere along the line that I don't understand. I had a picture in the passing scene book about 2 or 3 years ago, and you didn't have all those steps to go into the front door as had been in more recent times. They've used this building in times gone by for music classes. I remember when my sons were in school, they came over from Jacksonwald Elementary to this building and they had some music classes in there. The other side, I mean the next one, that's the side facing sort of eastwardly. And notice that there was a cellar door there and there was a cellar in at least part of the building. I was curious to go inside, but I thought that maybe I shouldn't.
Because it looks like they're digging out the foundation.
Yeah, they really are. And the next one. That was the back. Is there another picture? My darn. That I took today. And I noticed that there are some Amish people who are working on that project. They were really working very extensively today as I drove by. The building was built in 1870 by the same people who built Schwarzwald Union Church. That building still stands as the Schwarzwald United Church of Christ a block away. Exeter Township, when they accepted the Public School Act about 1850, used the old Schwarzwald parochial schoolhouse, which was in part of the where the cemetery, where the old part of the cemetery and the parking lot would be today. And in 1870, they gave up the use of the old Schwarzwald parochial school and built this building. So that the two both date from 1870, and they were built by the same individuals. That building has been at Jackson. By the way, Jackson Mold itself dates from the very same year of 1870. A lot of activity went on in 1870. Some of the people who are old enough remember the old hotel right across the street where the bank now sits, John Jackson's Hotel, also 1870, and the post office at Jackson Mold was started in 1870. The same year as Limekiln Post Office also dates from 1870. The next picture, please. Here's one. I started to show this, I think, about 2 months ago. This was labeled the Close, C-L-O-S-E, homestead. Obviously a farm building in Berks County, and it was on eBay. This was a ferrotype print, or a tin type, a really early one that was in terrible shape. I doctored it up so that you could actually see it, because in the original form, it's very, very dark. Does anyone recognize that building? I would love to use it in one of the passing scene books, but I can't use it unless I can positively identify it and perhaps take a picture of the structure as it now exists. It was labeled the Close Homestead. Now, I know there was a Close Homestead around Stonetown, but I don't think that this was it. If anyone recognizes that, please call the Historical Society and give the message to someone who answers the phone, and they will pass it on to me. I would love to be able to use that picture. It's a rare one. I'm going to guess it's 1875, 78, and a neat picture. I would guess that that building survives in some form. I'm sure the picket fences are gone, and I'm sure the outbuildings are gone, but I'll bet that the house still stands somewhere. This is a public road, I believe, although I'm not sure about that, where the buggy sits in the foreground. Okay, the next one. We're working on the next issue of The Passing Scene, Volume 19, which will be coming out in November, probably sometime a little after the middle of November. And what we try to do with all the Passing Scene books, which actually doubles the amount of labor involved, is that from as many of the photographs as we can, of the old photographs, I try to go to the same site today to get a present-day shot as a point of reference, a now-and-then sort of thing. This was the Reformed Church at Bethel, along Route, it fronts on Route 501, right as you're coming into Bethel Village in Bethel Township. Next one. I returned this past weekend, Monday, we took this picture. And today, there must be an independent Reformed church, because the sign says there about Salem Reformed Church of Bethel. Can you go back again, just to compare the fronts? Notice that there is a difference in the steeple. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking that they elongated that church, because if you look up there, I'm seeing five windows across the side, two windows across the bottom, and a doorway. So in other words, five portals. The next, and that, it looks to be somewhere about six, seven or so. Yeah.
I wonder if it was right around where the chimney was.
The steeple is different, and but if they, whenever they added, they certainly did it very well, because the windows all seemed to match. So that was a well done job. Anyhow, that Salem Reformed Church in Bethel, right along Route 501, Bethel, and if you go down 501, you eventually wind up in Mount Etna. The next. Yes, Larry Haynes made this picture available, and he has relatives on this photograph, Redding Beer. A really very interesting picture, and when you see it on the printed page, you'll be able to read all the little posters that are in this view. You can't see them just too well on here, but it's a great picture taken at the Reading Brewery, which used to be on West Elm Street or Hockley Lane. That was built on Hockley Lane, later on West Elm. Next.
Ice?
Yeah. Yes, they're harvesting ice. That's a really great picture. Yeah. They're harvesting ice, and the picture was taken at Dauberville. Some of you might remember there was a big ice dam at Dauberville, which was drained a number of years ago. I don't know exactly when. I have to do some research on that. I do remember that during Tropical Storm Agnes in 1972, Dauberville was in the radio news all day long because they were afraid that the dam would burst. And that held an enormous amount of water at one time. I don't know if you remember that, Sime.
I remember Dauberville, and I remember the Dauberville Dam, but now, right now, I'm trying to place it in my geographic map in my head.
It would sort of face the railroad that passes, that goes through the village, heading northward. I'm going to go there. I remember the dam. But I don't remember when it was drained, although someone told me it was drained quite a... If any of the home viewers remember when it was drained, please give us a call. I'd like to know that. But that is a rare picture. That shows that was quite an operation. Look at the number of men who were involved there and the big ice house. But those who remember Tropical Storm Agnes will remember that that was... they were holding their breath because they thought surely that dam would break. It didn't. Next. 1940, the Leesport Public School in West Leesport, now the headquarters of the Leesport Area Historical Society. I was hired to teach in the Schuylkill Valley School System in the summer of 1959, and I was going to be assigned to that building. As it turned out, there were plans afoot at that time to close the building, and I wound up in the basement of Burn Township Consolidated School, teaching sixth grade for 1 year. That was a very memorable year because in those days you never took your coat off when you taught, and there was a huge pipe and right behind my desk, almost touched my back, supplying hot water to the kitchen, to the cafeteria. The windows were painted shut. I was in the basement. And I thought surely that by Christmas, if I survived by Christmas time, I'd make it through the year, and I did. That was school year 1959-1960.
Well, when you say Consolidated School, was that Burn Township Elementary?
That's it.
That's where I went.
Yeah.
No kidding.
Mm-hmm. I taught there in 59, school year 59-60.
Huh.
And then I left for Alice's Consolidated School the following year. That was a great building. It had some very fine teachers. It was a nice building. Dr. Francis Dietrich was principal at the time that I was there at Burn Township. But this was the West Leesport School, part of the Schuylkill Valley School System, and again, now headquarters for the Historical Society, the Leesport Area Historical Society. Let's take a little break. And Kim, do you have some things that you want to share?
We're about ready to go to break, aren't we?
Are we ready to go to break? I guess we could do that, couldn't we? Okay, let's go to break.
BCTV gives me a chance to educate you about my favorite subject, dogs.
It's a great place to learn about local history.
The pulse of not only the city of Reading, but also Berks County.
It is a very valuable resource, a tool for our community that allows our community in Berks County to connect.
It's where I turn to whenever I want to get information about what's going on in the area.
So tune in today.
We're back. Let's switch over to Kim, who's going to give us some fascinating information about, I guess, some discoveries that you've made.
Oh, we made a big discovery today.
Big discoveries.
First, this is
an appropriate time to discover this.
Oh, yeah.
Timely is the word.
Yeah. First, let me reiterate that we are still looking for volunteers, thank you, on Friday and Saturday.
Well, I thought we just got one.
But we need more.
Okay, all right.
Seriously, we do. We... while we appreciate interest on Tuesday through Thursday, we have so many volunteers, we're not quite sure where to put the researchers. But we're really running low on Friday and Saturday. And as you know, we're getting ready for our busy season, which starts anytime now. We're waiting.
But you're always busy with all the files that
we are. Whether we're dealing with researchers or collections, there is never a dull moment at the library. Poor Bill Rear. I'm hoping he stays. We handed him a collection and in the process discovered that it's been processed very incorrectly and actually is a combination of three collections. And then we opened a box, and I'm going to show you what we found. We basically found bundles of documents. Very, you know, at first overwhelming. This is just one. I think there's two more boxes of this stuff. And what it is, basically, is correspondence and muster rolls and supply lists and stuff like that that was written during the Civil War. And this package right here, what we found is a bulk of the correspondence is to and from Captain McKnight. And for those of you who aren't quite familiar, he is the commander of the Ringgold Light Artillery when it was first formed. This is a huge discovery. It's been in the collection forever. We just didn't realize that we had it because it was kind of processed incorrectly.
Well, and let's also, to set the context correctly, and to your credit, for many years, you know, with the advent of roots in the 1970s, genealogy became the, you know, the mainstay of most historical societies, and that's what they focused on. But Kim, being an archivist and a historian in her background, you know, she appreciates the significance of scholarly researches in addition to the genealogical research. So Kim has been processing many of these collections so that she could provide that information to the scholarly researchers mm-hmm. as well.
And this is all through the help of volunteers. We're going to take a bundle like this, and what's going to end up happening is it's going to...
Before.
This is the before, and then this is the after. This is literally what we do. Yeah. We go document by document through the collection, organize it into boxes, and make it available through the database online.
When you get through processing it down to the item level, you will have a finding guide
that
will be available online for people who are in California and have an interest in this. They can look at that finding guide and see everything that's in there.
That's right. On our website, if you have not been to our website, the finding guide is keyword searchable. And it's also, there's a drop-down box where you can search the collection in its entirety. So what's shown on the website are the collections that we're either have finished or we're currently working on. So you can see how far we've progressed. They're by no means all of the ones that we have. This is the, as you're walking into the next picture, is when you're walking into our vault, and this is just one wall. I've shown pictures of the high-density shelving. This is another aspect of it. Our main goal at the Henry Johnson Library is preservation and accessibility. This is, by the way, Captain McKnight. I thought I'd pop that in there.
Sure.
One of the things that we're responsible for doing is making sure everything's neat and organized. This is the Tofshine case. When I first got there, the Tofshines did not look like that. They looked worse than that. And
those look nice.
They look nice. And the documents, believe it or not, documents can be crushed and broken. The weight is equally distributed. There's no shifting. If I were to go into the middle of one of those shelves, into the middle of one of those piles, and yank something out, nothing around it's going to get damaged because they're the same size and they're arranged the same. Unfortunately, I don't have a before picture, but I do have a before picture of our deeds. I mentioned last month, that we started working on all of our old deeds. This is one of the reasons why. When you open up the drawers, they literally kind of pop up at you. It's an interesting feature.
They're stuffed in there.
They are. And as you can see, I try not to open them, but you know, the document on top is starting to tear because it's up where it's hitting the top of the drawer. You know, this is another example of what they look like. And by the time we're done, it's going to look like that.
You must make the people should be aware that the value of some of our deeds is in the fact that not all of those deeds are recorded. You know, years ago, if you lived out in the boonies, getting into the courthouse in Reading in the 1700s was no minor affair. And people simply held on to their deeds. That's why you see these old cartoons where they're guarding their deeds and someone's trying to take the deed away, because that deed was proof of your ownership of a certain property. If the place burned down and you lost your deed, you had a problem, which is why people made a major effort to have their deeds recorded. But again, not all deeds are recorded. We do have quite a number of unrecorded deeds. The point should also be made about finding things every now and again at the society that no one is aware of. I know for a fact when I first joined the society nearly 52 years ago, they had Mrs. Sanders, who was the executive director, the librarian, did correspondence, did genealogy work. We had Mrs. Mengel, who worked half a day answering the phone in spite of the fact that she was nearly deaf. And we had a half-time custodian who was 86. And things would come in. And they were simply, there was always a concern about preserving things for posterity. So things were taken. As a matter of fact, things were brought in at the old Historical Society on North 4th Street. And when they opened the new building in the late 1920s, they brought boxes over from North 4th Street, and they were carried up to the attic at our present location, 940, and some of those things were up in the attic until fairly recent years when they were brought down.
There's still items up.
Oh, there's
attic.
Still items, simply because, you know, it was a problem with a lack of personnel. We didn't have many volunteers those days, so they were actually operating basically with Mrs. Sanders herself, and she did what she could, but we preserved the things, and they're there. It just took us a while to process them.
Well, and one of
like 50 years.
50 years. Yeah. Thank you. And we're having fun. Don't get me wrong. I mean, it's overwhelming and tedious, but it's really kind of fun. And one of the reasons why I'm bringing this up is because we've kind of instituted an adopt a collection program. And
hold that up.
Sorry. As you can imagine, archival supplies are rather expensive.
Oh, yes.
And, you know, that the one little bundle, it looks to be a couple thousand documents, which is going to require a couple thousand folders. And what we're hoping is that if you cannot donate your time, please consider donating to a collection to help us buy the supplies we need to process it. There's a lot of, you know, really good items that we have, and we want to make sure that we can preserve them for the future. But unfortunately, we can only do little bits when we can, you know, when we have the money to purchase supplies.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, if you decide to adopt a collection, you will be recognized for your generosity. And one of the great things that Kim's doing with the processing of these collections, these are priceless. These are one of a kind. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't find them anyplace else. They're unique to our community, and they are what make our community special. But they don't do anyone anybody any good if people can't come and use them. And there are a lot of researchers who would be very, very interested, a lot of graduate students, a lot of professors, many people just interested in their legacy, who would be love to come in here and be able to use these things. But again, they can't use them if they're not processed. So we'd appreciate your help if you could help us do that, make them available to the community.
I did throw in, this is for Syme, one of the first things I did when I started is I told him we needed a humidification chamber, and he's been trying to get me to bring this on ever since. I keep saying no. But these are documents that we just got from the county, and basically, and it'll leads into the humidification process. These documents, at one point, I think the county owned something like 43 bridges.
Oh, yeah.
Roughly. And what these little packets are they're the petitions from the community, the specifications, the proposals, and the blueprints for the bridges that were built in that location. And I actually brought some. I can try to take them out.
That's very interesting.
In order to process this collection, the first thing we have to do is we have to put it in the humidifier, which this is one of the aspects of the humidification chamber, because when he asked me how much is it going to cost, I said, how much do you have to buy two garbage cans?
Yeah, it's that simple.
This is the interior. This is the kind of like the bucket that the documents go into. And then it sits in a larger garbage can, which I have a note on top not to throw anything into. You put distilled water into the bottom, build up the humidity. You can stick the documents inside. It's supposed to be 24 hours, but because we have a very good HVAC system, it's 48, because it's hard to build up a lot of humidity in there. If you can get a really good heat source, it's really 24 hours. Pull them out, flatten them, and then you can process the documents. He's been trying to get me to bring that on, and I keep saying no. So here are the pictures for you.
It's no more complicated than that. I mean, you know, that should all of our solutions be that cheap?
Okay. Sometimes even sticking documents in a hot shower, don't put them in the water, just in the room, can kind of relax documents enough.
What happens after the water evaporates from the document then?
Well, the stuff that you put in, it won't. It goes back into the document to make it, because documents dry out, and when they dry out, they become brittle and flake apart. So when you reintroduce water into the document, it kind of revitalizes it a little.
It doesn't go back curling again after it doesn't?
Okay. Nope.
If that you would get take a number of years, it could.
Yeah, I can take something that looks just like that, and probably within 2 weeks, it'll be perfectly flat.
Wow.
And all it is reintroducing water into the item with a nifty thing.
Well, and
like
you do
that.
Control the humidity at the society and at the library. That makes a big difference,
yeah,
too.
We do.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
That's neat.
Because most homes are as dry as the Atacama Desert, and that's true.
Yeah.
Well,
people don't, like 7% humidity in many homes,
right,
especially if they have forced air heat.
Right, and if you store things in attics and basements without proper temperature control, you're getting heating and cooling, heating and cooling, and that damages. If you do have documents that you want to preserve, they're curled, don't open them. Stick them in the shower, somewhere in the bathroom, relax them a little, and then you can open them. Because if you try to pry them open, they will break. We haven't opened a lot of, because this is one of the packets, we haven't opened these. First off, it's a new donation and it hasn't been accepted yet, but we haven't quite started opening these because we know that they're dry and we don't want to ruin them. So one of the first things we're going to do is we're going to stick them in the garbage can. We're not throwing them out, but it seems weird to say that. We're throwing documents in the garbage can.
You're going
to
put them in that packet.
Yeah, we'll take them out of the envelope.
Oh, you will take them out of the envelope before you
stick them inside, and the water will circulate. And it'll flatten them out.
Yeah, neat.
We have a lot of nifty things at the library, not just documents.
Getting back to the collection Chief Rare's or former Chief Rare's working on. How long do you think, based on what his progress he's made so far, how long do you think it'll take to process that collection?
Honestly,
yeah.
There's at least he only works one day a week. No offense. Good job. Come back. At that rate, it's going to take a year or two.
Okay.
Because, I mean, he'll have to go through each packet and try to group them into categories. And then when he's done grouping them into categories, he has to take each category and filter out more. Like, it's really a kind of like it's a reverse tree.
Right.
We kind of start at the top and work down, and it gets bigger as you go down. So it could take, if we can find an interested party who's willing to assist him, it'll take. I mean, it's the 150th anniversary of the Civil War.
And that's what George was
alluding
to earlier.
We're hoping it's done by Gettysburg.
Well, that's right. But yeah, was General McKnight at Gettysburg?
I think so.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's, I mean, we've got 5 years for it. So if he gets it done in one or two, we're good.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's like I keep telling people, you never know what you're going to find. It's
That's
like Christmas
true.
Every mm-hmm. time you open up a box. Yeah.
But at least we preserved the things.
That's
They're there.
That's right.
So we did the best we could and continue to do the same.
Yeah.
Well, that's it. Simon, is there anything you want to add before I go on with a few more pictures?
Real quick, George, I want to talk about Vicki Hefner's. Vicki Hefner is our education curator at the Historical Society, and she's got her annual Junior Historian Summer Camp. It's part of the youth education program at the Historical Society, and that's going to take place on, Tuesday, June 21st, Wednesday, the 22nd of June, and Thursday, the 23rd. It takes place from 9:30 a.m. to 3 p.m. It's going to be taking place at the Historical Society's main location at 940 Center Avenue. And we do this as an education program to inform young Americans on their roots and how we've become the society that we've become through the activities and the work projects and things like that that took place many years ago. It's a hands-on activity day. They're going to be working on things like basket weaving, and Berks County was one of the premier vessel manufacturers in its early history during the 18th and 19th century. They're also going to be working on frock tours. They'll get practical hands-on experience there. More fun thing, making paper dolls. And thermotropes, which I had absolutely no idea what a thermotrope was, but Vicki told me, and I'll just real briefly here, thermotropes were a toy that kids during the early, during the Victorian era would use. And if you look on here, there's two plates. There's a disc, and you're looking at two sides of a disc, the colored one and then the black and white. And there was a string that went on either side of the thermotrope, and they would pull them out and they would spin, and it was sort of like a very early motion picture.
It's like putting the bird in the bird cage, but not really putting the bird
exactly.
In the bird cage.
And so that's kind of neat. So they have that. They have the thermotropes. They're doing tin punching. They're making memory bottles, and that's a photograph of a memory bottle. So they're going to be doing that. And if you have absolutely no idea what any of these activities are, just I suggest you enroll your child today, and they'll come home and tell you all about them. But anyway, it's going to be taking place on June 21st, 22nd, 23rd, 9:30 to 3 p.m. The cost on it is $35 for 1776 Club members, $50 for non-members. But we do ask that you register prior to June 10th. So that's what's going on in the Youth Education Department over at the Historical Society.
Okay. We had a video to show you tonight that was just put on YouTube. The people, you who are watching, who fool around with your computers, I'm sure know about YouTube. There must be a million videos free on YouTube. I put a video on last week of a piano recital that was held at the Goggle Center, and it had to do with a piece written by Dr. Chester Battelle. People who've been around the county and around the city of Reading for years know about Chester Battelle because of his involvement with what had been the Y. Missing Institute of Fine Arts. He was one of the most accomplished pianists that Berks County ever produced. It was Dr. Battelle, a very, very bright man, taught piano, composed quite a number of pieces.
We just got the sheet music for a symphony.
Did you?
It's in the suitcase in my office.
Did you really?
It's for almost every piece of all the instruments that are...
He wrote two major symphonies, the Romantic Symphony and... What's the other one? The American Symphony?
Yeah, I'm not sure which one it is, but it's...
With all the parts.
20 booklets.
Yeah,
all
that's fantastic. And the Reading Symphony, years ago, performed those things. He was a guest artist with the Reading Symphony years ago. Anyhow, the point that I'm making is... I have put on maybe about 120 videos on YouTube, and I've tried to get on as many people of local origin that I can. I have Chester Battelle's compositions. I have Anthony Mundy, the accordionist, who was a headliner in vaudeville years ago. Arthur Schutt, who was probably the finest jazz pianist and also a classical pianist that ever came out of Berks County. He played with everybody who was somebody. All the big bands had Arthur Schutt. Paul Allhouse, of course, from Reading the Tenor. Now, how do you find those things on YouTube? It's very easy. I've keyed every one of the videos that I have put on using my initials. and my license plate number. Just go to YouTube and do a search for GMMIX, and over 100 videos will line up, and you can hear Chester Battell's compositions, you can hear the Trick Sisters, you can hear Anthony Mundy, you can hear Arthur Schutt. There's a lot there, and I put on a great number of Berks County things. One of the most exciting things recently that I've put up is are two recordings that were made for the Thomas Edison Company with Arthur Schutt, made about 1926. They're fantastic. The sound is great, and the music is very, very impressive. So go to YouTube, it's free, and type in GMMIX, and you will get all the videos that I have put on YouTube. And there's a description of every piece that I put up, and I have a biographical sketch of everybody who is local included with those videos. I wanted to make that point because we just couldn't. We just couldn't get the thing to work tonight with a video that I wanted to show you. But now we have a few more things to show you. Kim or somebody? The next image, please. Neat picture.
That's a nice bike.
That is a Reading Standard, made by the Reading Standard motorbike. Early, we're talking about 1903 or so. I have the whole original catalog, thanks to Jeff Holman. I have the complete catalog, very, very rare. Only one is known to exist. And that is called the Thor, T-H-O-R, which was the Reading Standard Manufacturing Company. That was their motor bicycle. A neat, neat motorcycle. I'm not sure that any survives. Hmm. But there are some Reading Standards, because I saw a Reading Standard very recently on display. But those were the motorcycles. And, of course, they also made just regular bicycles as well. They were made at the Rempus Ironworks, which was down near the Bingaman Street Bridge, right along, it faced the canal and the Schuylkill River, just up from the Bingaman Street or the Lancaster Avenue Bridge was where most of those were made. Next. That is a really, really rare and neat picture, thanks to our good friend Chris Papadakis, who has been very generous at making things available from his collection and his sales to me for the Passing Scene books for the benefit of the Historical Society. What a great picture that is. That's Heister's, Johnny Heister's canal boat, the Rosa, one of two excursion boats that he used in later years. And you're down in the area of Robinson Town. Well, that's down near your place.
Okay.
That's Robinson Township in the general area of Gibraltar along the Schuylkill Canal. And I guess they're heading for Old Maid's Woods or some such place up canal. But look at that group. There's an American flag flying there on the left-hand side. There's a guy playing the drum that you see right above near the A of Rosa. And I don't know whether you can see it, but near the smokestack there's a guy with a mandolin. Hmm. A really neat picture. I remember on something like Memorial Day and some of the big weekends, Decoration Day, the big weekends, they used to have those canal boats loaded down with over 100 people. And Howard said that they had so many people on from time to time that the water came up almost to the railing. They really had those boats loaded. But isn't that a neat picture?
Yeah,
that is
sure.
An incredible picture. And the original, this picture on the screen doesn't do it justice. It's a really great picture. And we thank Chris Papadakis of West Lawn for making that available. Do you realize that about half the pictures, well, I shouldn't say half, three quarters of the pictures that will be in the Passing Scene books are photographs that were lent by people for publication purposes, for the benefit of the Historical Society, and to preserve them for posterity, because old pictures have a way over the course of time of getting lost. And once they're on good paper and they're in print, they're saved. The next one, please. Mm. Do you recognize this?
That's the meeting house.
That's the Exeter Friends meeting house. Laura Hopkins took that picture the day that the Exeter Friends Meeting House caught fire. There was a problem with the chimney, and luckily, I think she had her cell phone with her and was able to capture that picture with her cell phone. But isn't that a neat picture?
Yeah.
I mean, it's bad for the meeting house. What they discovered was that apparently there was a problem before because the structural boarding beneath that roof was replaced. It wasn't all that old. You can tell by the cut of the wood that it was something that might have been replaced in the 1950s. So the important part of the meeting house with the original woodwork down below, that didn't burn. And thank goodness someone was there that they could do something about that fire the minute it caught. But that's a great picture in color of the fire of the Exeter Friends Meeting House, what, about 2 months ago, I guess, by this time. Mm-hmm. Exeter Township on Meeting House Road. Next. I'm not sure exactly when those pictures were taken. I'm hoping that Joe D'Angelo or some of the people who are familiar with the transportation aspects of Reading's history, they'll recognize when those buses were purchased. I know that in 1947, the last of the trolleys ran in Reading, and the trolleys were replaced by buses. I was on the Schuylkill Avenue trolley the last day that it ran in 1947, and they brought in buses that took the place. This was the shipment of the new buses that came in, and they were being readied for their initial runs. I'm guessing it would be sometime in the late 40s, but I don't know that for sure. Again, I must do some research on that. I just grabbed this picture today and threw it in for this evening, hoping that somebody could give us some information. The next picture, please. I must do some work on this. The Windsor Township, Hamburg area, the Windsor Township Water Company. That picture sort of speaks for itself. These are obviously very old pictures. That apparently, I don't know whether this is a filtering process or what's going on there, but I'm going to have to do some research. I do have written material on this, but I have just begun. The next one. There were four pictures in this series. I don't know whether you can see that. On the original, you can. There's hardware and there's like pumping. There's piping there between those two men in the center of the picture. The next view. A storage area, a storage building at Windsor Waterworks. Next. And that building. Now, I don't know where that building still stands. Maybe I plan to go up to Hamburg sometime very soon to check into what's up there yet. That picture, I've never seen another copy of that picture. Maybe there are some, but I have never seen them. I think they're sort of giving us the clue that it's time to wrap it up. So tell your friends about our program, which is on live the first Wednesday of each month at 7. The program repeats this Friday night at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Remember, it can also be seen anywhere on the face of the earth on the Historical Society's website. Thanks to today's panel, Sime Burlett and Kimberly Richards, and yours truly, I'm George M. Meiser IX, your host and a 51-year member of the Society. We look forward to having you join us again on the first Wednesday in July. Be here, look for us. Thank you for watching.